and welcome to Booklust. I'm Nancy Pearl. My guest today at University Bookstore is novelist Laurie Frankel. Laurie, thank you so much for coming by.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so glad to be here.
Well, I have many questions to ask about your books, about your writing process, about all those things that have gone into making you a writer. So let's start with the last. Did you always know you wanted to write?
I always knew I wanted to write, but I didn't know how for a really long time. And it took me a while to figure that out. When I got to college, I started doing all the academic writing that you do, and I was really good at that. So then I went to graduate school, and that was more about reading than writing. And those two things go together, of course, but it was strange, that transformation for me. And so it actually took dropping out of graduate school before I realized, oh, I could write fiction, and that's what I really wanted to be doing.
And were you an English major? Is that the what
I was
the,
an English major. Uh-huh. I was an English major, and then I went to graduate school for literature, Shakespeare, actually.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so it's so like high literature.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And but had you always been a reader?
Always. Uh-huh. Yes. Yeah. And I feel like that's where it comes from primarily. People who are really big readers, I think, really frequently think to themselves, I could do this. I should try this. Reading a lot makes me wanna write more. And so the more and more I read, the further I got from actually thinking I was gonna finish graduate school, and the more I went towards thinking I wanna write this instead.
Mm-hmm. You're now have two novels published.
Yes.
The newest one is Goodbye for Now. The first one was The Atlas of Love.
Yes.
They both have great covers, very different covers.
Very different covers.
When you're writing, when you're in the process of working on a novel, do you still read a lot?
Yes, I do. And I know a lot of people don't. I know a lot of people stop reading while they're writing.
And that's because they feel that the voice,
yeah,
from the book they're reading will kind of bleed into what they're writing.
Yeah, and I get that, but I go the opposite direction. I read more when I'm writing than when I'm not. And in fact, I often read, like, actually while I'm writing. I'll be typing, and then I'll stop and think. Often when I run into problems, I think, okay, who has solved this problem and how? And then I can go to my shelf and find that and read it and go back to what I'm doing. So I often switch back and forth, you know, over the course of the day.
Uh-huh.
And then always when I'm writing, when I stop for the day, I get mired in whatever it is that I'm reading. Always. Sometimes I try to, like when I was writing this one, it was in third person, so I was only reading things written in third person.
Uh-huh.
I didn't want to like tease myself with the first person that I could not have, but otherwise I'm always reading when I'm writing. And I find it really difficult to imagine writing without also reading during it. So I know a lot of people who go that route, and I kind of look at them like, tell me how. How do you pull that off? Because
uh-huh.
I can't do it at all.
Who did you read? Maybe not mentors,
yeah,
but the kind of writing that you would want to do.
Yeah. Richard Russo is someone I go back to over and over again. David Mitchell is someone I go back to over and over again. David Mitchell used to be this sort of obscure fellow, and now this Cloud
right.
Atlas has come out, and everyone is knowing him, and I feel like, oh, he was mine first.
Right.
I loved him. Ruth Ozeki is someone I go back to over and over again. She's a new book coming
she
out
this
spring.
She has a new
spring.
Book coming out this spring.
Can't
She's
going
to actually be here in
oh, good.
January for mid for
yes.
American Library
right.
Association's
yes.
midwinter.
Yes, I'm hoping to get together with her.
Did you know her from?
I met her through my agent.
Uh-huh.
And in fact, I met my agent through her, actually.
Uh-huh.
When I went to find an agent, I looked at the back of her books to find out who hers was and,
uh-huh.
and asked her. And so then that was great, because later I could say, psst, you know, by the way, could you introduce
right.
us? Could you set us up? That would be great.
Uh-huh.
And I reread her books all the time. Margaret Atwood is another one who I just reread it because she solves problems that I run into in ways that I find really helpful. Mark Hayden is another one.
Uh-huh.
His problem solving is really informative.
So talk about one of those problems. Like what sort of thing?
with the first one, with the Atlas of Love, I was really worried that the chapters were too many and too short. I became worried about it because when I started reading about querying, they all say, oh, you can send your first chapter. And my first chapter was 3 pages long. And mm-hmm. I thought, oh, no. And Mark Haddon's second book is called A Spot of Bother. And he has these teeny tiny short chapters, like a page a piece chapters. And he totally pulls that off. And really beautifully, too, by switching back and forth between characters and scenes. And I thought, oh yeah, okay, that's how he does that, and I can do that. I can do that too. Mm-hmm. The books couldn't be more different from one another. Mm-hmm. But that notion of what short chapters might buy you and how to pull them off, that's what I did. I mm-hmm. thought, okay, who has done this? What book can I think of with really short chapters? And that was the one. And it's my favorite of his. Uh-huh. Everybody liked the first one, the curious incident of the dog uh-huh. in the nighttime. And I love that one too. But the second quiet book is my favorite. Uh-huh.
When you sat down to do Goodbye for Now, your second novel, were there specific decisions that you had to make right at the beginning when you were kind of conceiving of the novel? Third person, first person, you know, point of view, voice.
Yeah, for sure. And I think those decisions are really hard. And then they almost always, you labor over them because they're beginning decisions and then they get undone, in my experience, later on as you go through. This Goodbye for Now actually started as a play. It came to me whole, which is a miracle. I love it when that happens. I don't know whether I can ever expect it to happen again. But just sitting on the sofa one night, I thought, aha, came into my brain and there it was. I had the idea for the technology personally for a long time, but not in the form that I was going to tell it as a story. And then I thought it was a play. And it was when I was sort of in the end stages of the Atlas of Love that I started thinking this and I started writing it as a play. But then in between those two things happening, I became a novelist and I had a literary agent. And so I thought, it needs to be transferred over and become mm-hmm. a novel. And in doing so, the story changed a lot, a lot, especially in the order in which it was told. And I didn't know that until I sat down and started writing it and wrote the first 100 pages of it that were very, very, very bad, and then I needed to start it over again. And then it all came very quickly. But that transition necessitated not only a transition of the medium, but a transition of characters and the order in which it was being told, and in fact, the moral of the story and the approach and the whole bit. Mm-hmm.
So this would be a good time to tell our viewers and listeners.
Yes.
Give us the elevator version of Goodbye for Now.
Goodbye for Now is a love story about a software engineer who invents a way for people to email and eventually video chat with their dead loved ones.
That's
thank
good. Because it's a hard book to summarize.
It is, yes. It's taken some practice, yes. But now I've got it down.
So there's a lot of maybe speculative technology in it. And you interviewed software engineers, or did that all happen?
Well, I'm married to a software engineer.
I knew you were going to say that. I did not know that, and I knew you were going to. You had an in-house software engineer.
Exactly right. I had in-house help. Mm-hmm. In-house help, and I don't think I could have done it otherwise. It's the kind of thing where, it's like mid-sentence help, where you're like, hey, can I have, why isn't this working? Can I have this thing? Mm-hmm. I think that's what you need. You need live-in, in-house help for that sort of thing. So I had that. When I pitched it in the first place, I thought it was going to be science fiction. I thought the technology was going to be really far-fetched. And by the time I finished writing it, it wasn't anymore, which was in part because I dialed it back, but it was in part because the technology caught up. Uh-huh. It's really, really remarkable. It's been incredible to watch how much this stuff that I initially conceived of as being really speculative fiction uh-huh. And requiring this leap of faith, in fact, isn't anymore. All sorts of people are doing the sort of first steps of what's going on in Goodbye for Now, which I find kind of creepy and alarming. And I feel like if I find it creepy and alarming, it must be creepy and alarming, because I've been thinking about this for a really long time.
Do you think this came out of some sort of subconscious need on your part or desire on your part to experience what the characters in the book experience?
Right. Yeah, unfortunately, not even subconscious, like actually conscious.
Really?
When my grandmother died, my grandmother and I emailed a lot, and when she died, it seemed like a pretty easy software problem to me to recreate those emails so that I could still have her in my inbox. Mm-hmm. We emailed a lot, but we also lived very near one another, so I saw her a lot. So they weren't very complicated, complex emails. They were fairly mundane and predictable. Mm-hmm. And it just seemed to me that a clever software engineer could fake those persuasively, and I knew it couldn't have her back, but I just thought it would be really nice to get these little emails in my inbox right. that said she loved me and was thinking of me, and that made really good sense to me. And I thought of it very soon after she died and sat with it for like 2.5 years before one night sitting on my sofa I thought, oh no, this is a terrible idea for a product, and also I don't make products, and also right. I don't know anything about software. This is a really good idea for a play or a novel.
That's great.
It's grandmothers feature prominently in both of my novels and the one I've just started, and I think they would be very happy, both of them, with these books, but it's a little heartbreaking that they didn't live to right. to see them in print.
So with the Atlas of Love, when you were writing that, did you have a contract in place or did you finish it first?
I finished it first. I didn't know anything about contracts. I didn't know anything about anything at the time. I went to the library. I checked out a book about how to write a query letter. Then I checked out like 6 or 7 books on how to write a query letter because they're really scary and alarming. Mm-hmm. And then I looked at the back of Ruth Ozeki's first novel and I sent a query letter to her agent. That's what I did. Who has been so, so wonderful to me.
And do you want to say who it is?
Her name is Molly Friedrich. She's a rock star in every way, and also she's become family. And she's been remarkable to me. And so I sent her this letter, and she emailed me, which I never thought was going to happen,
right.
and said, sure, send me the manuscript, which I was in no way prepared to do. It was done, but it wasn't formatted or anything
right.
like that. And I panicked, and then I sent it to her, and then I sent it to her again and said, oh no, I think I did this thing wrong and this thing wrong. And then she called a week later and said, yeah, this is great. And she had some suggestions and some things we were going to change. But it was the greatest phone call I have ever received mm-hmm. in my life, to pick up the phone. And she said, is Laurie there? And I said, this is she. And she said, this is Molly Friedrich. And I really thought I was going
to
fall over.
Like slumped down to the floor.
It was amazing.
Yeah. And so what kind of suggestions did she make? And how easy was that for you to take her advice?
Super easy, because I knew nothing and figured uh-huh. she knew everything.
Uh-huh.
And she does, and I continue to be very new to this game, which is a game and which is ever-changing and very complicated. And two, writing is so isolating. I read it and husband reads it and we talk about it, but then it went out into the world and she had thoughts and other people who she worked with had thoughts, and that was so valuable to me. Mostly the Atlas of Love. The Atlas of Love is about three women who raise a baby together, and those three women are in graduate school for literature, and she felt that it was way too academic. Mm-hmm. The first chapter was about Foucault, and she very patiently explained to me that no one cares about Foucault, and I honestly didn't know that, because in my world,
right.
everyone cared a lot about Foucault. it seems absurd to say this now, but it's true.
No, it is true.
Yeah,
sure.
and so she helped me figure that out. And so some of it was really specific, like this first chapter was terrible. In fact, what she said to me was, if the query letter hadn't been good, I would never have read beyond the first 3-page chapter.
Wow.
Because it was that bad and wrong. And then some of it was more like, I get into this book at about page 40. Fix that.
Uh-huh.
And so it was, some of it was very specific and some of it was less so. But to have a partner suddenly to work on this with me who believed in it
right.
made all the difference.
And so when she would say something like, I got into this book at page 40,
yeah.
fix that. But there's a big step between what she means and how you're going to.
Yes, and it had to happen pretty quickly too. You know, we were not under contract, there was nothing binding, but she thought, a month ish mm-hmm. would be a good idea. And this was, it was just after midterm. I was in the middle of a semester. I was teaching full time. It was quite an undertaking, but it's having somebody else give me some direction mm-hmm. just helped so much. Mm-hmm. Because otherwise it was just me and my brain thinking right. about it and rewriting and reading it out loud, and that was going nowhere. So it was just as if she gave me a direction, and then I could get there, mm-hmm. But I needed to be pointed that way because
right.
I didn't know which way to go
right.
on my own.
Yeah, so it's not exactly a road map, but it's you know, go east.
Yes, right. Yes, exactly.
Something like that, you know.
Head That's east. The way.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And so then, you know, then I felt like I could figure that out. I could do it. I just needed a start. And what was also unbelievably helpful was to have somebody as amazing as she is say to me, "You are a good novelist. Good job." I had no idea. I had absolutely no idea. And until that moment, you know, I didn't know whether I was doing this just for fun, if anything was ever going to happen with it. Mm-hmm. So all of those things helped tremendously.
So the writing of it is fun?
The writing of it is fun. The revising of it I also really like. It's the promoting of it that I find really challenging. Mm-hmm. But the writing it is great. And then you have this first draft that is not good. And then you tinker with it, and then you have a second draft that is pretty good. And that's my favorite part, mm-hmm. where it's like miracles are happening. What feel like fairly minor adjustments change everything.
So now you have a young child.
Yes.
Who, if I'm remembering correctly, broke his leg.
Yes, he did.
Last
yes.
summer.
Yeah, it put a dent in the summer.
It put a great dent yeah. in the summer. So how do you manage the writing and the mothering
yeah.
and those kinds of practical issues?
Right, right. Childcare. He goes to school 4 days a week. I couldn't do it otherwise. I go on book tour. I go to bookstores, and one of the things that people say to me all the time is, "Oh, you're so lucky that you have a job that you can do at home with your kid." And I just think, either I'm writing the books wrong or I have the wrong kind of kid. But it's right. not even almost possible. He has to be out of the house in order for me to get really anything done at all. So he goes to school, and I work, and then he comes home, and you know, we have time.
And
to
then you're not a writer.
And then I'm not a writer at all. Uh-huh. I don't
right.
look at it. I don't touch it. I just find it very difficult to do those two things at one time.
Maybe because they're both so important to you.
Maybe because they're both so important to me, and also because they're both so hard. And they use really, for me, they use really different parts of my brain. Although I did rewrite parts of Atlas of Love after Daniel, when the manuscript was already in, because I thought, oh no, I was wrong about, you know, the mm-hmm. way that a child is, because I was just making children up at the time, and then I actually had one. And so everything changed. I think what's hard is that writing is something that you do on your sofa, in your house, on your laptop, in your pajamas, and therefore doesn't look like work. And so it seems like something, it seems to me and it seems to him and it seems to lots of people, like it's something that you could do while he was playing with Legos in the corner.
Right.
He doesn't want to play with Legos by himself.
Yeah.
He wants to play with Legos with me.
Right.
And if I'm reading something, he wants to be reading it too. Uh-huh. And I want that also.
Right.
We share that. So therefore he has to leave for some of it. And the way I think of it is, well, if I were an accountant and I went to work every day, nobody would think that would be compatible with bringing my kid with me. So I try to keep that in mind.
Sure.
It's not always easy. It is, however, an extraordinarily flexible job, writing. And that is really nice, because when they want people to come on a field trip or go to school and help out, I can do
right.
that. And and that's great.
So talk about, as a novelist, after when your first novel came out, when Atlas of Love came out, talk about the effect of reviews.
I was teaching full-time at the time.
And teaching high school, college?
College, University of Puget Sound.
Uh-huh.
And it came out 2 weeks maybe before the start of classes. And I felt like that changed a lot of things, but I don't think it did really. You know, anywhere but like in my heart. I felt like that gave me more like I knew a little bit more what I was talking about, and I felt like I could talk about the real world. I had a friend who said, after the first day of class, like, "Oh, were your students really impressed that you, you know, that you published a novel?" And I said, "No, they can't imagine what took me so long. Right. You know, they're college students. They think they're going to write 4 books before the end of the month, mm-hmm. and you know, become nuclear physicists, and you know, write 5 plays,
and
be in a
Nobel
rock band,
Prize.
And win the Nobel Prize." So I think it really only changed things for me. I don't read the reviews. I don't read them on Goodreads. I don't read them on Amazon. I don't read them. They would make me crazy. Mm-hmm. And there's so many things that make me crazy that I have no ability to control, but that's one that I do. So I just don't read them. And again, I know a lot of people who do and who try to control those and manipulate them or, you know, sort of think about their access to them and other people's access to them. And I just
yeah, I think I'm in your camp.
Yes. It's just going to upset me. If they were going to help me, then I would look at them.
Mm-hmm.
But many of them are wonderful and fabulous and warm and wonderful, and I will ignore all of them and read the one
right.
that is not. And that is stupid and a bad approach to things. So I just don't go there. I mean, I think that if I became a self-actualized human, that I would be able to read them and take in the good ones and let go of the bad ones and learn from that. And
or let go
wonderful.
Of both. I
or
think
let go
in
of both.
Buddhism,
right.
you should let,
oh, yes,
go, of
let
both.
Go of all things. Yes.
Right, right.
Yeah, I haven't mastered that one yet. Exactly. Yeah.
Yes.
And I like it. I think it's a great idea. But I haven't managed to pull it off yet. So I just don't look at them.
So when you talked about writing, you talked about it being such a solitary activity, and
yeah.
especially, and so that you're living in your world in which, for example, Foucault is really
you're
important.
Right.
do you belong to a writing group?
I don't. I belong to Seattle 7 Writers, which is a local organization that does a great deal of supporting readers and writers and literacy in the community and one another. And that has been extraordinarily wonderful. They've been so great to me. Just to have some support and other people to talk to and people to say, my editor says I need to do this. Is that true? How do I do this? Who do I call? Those kinds of things. But I am not in a writer's group, mostly because when I started writing, I was teaching full time and I needed to read other people's, like, not yet finished writing and make productive, useful, mm-hmm. critical, but not overly harsh comments on it, like a hole in the head, because I was grading papers all the time. And I couldn't grade any more papers, even different kinds of papers, even for friends.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I haven't done it, is because when I started, I wasn't doing it. So I think about doing it now, but it's very hard, and it's, for me, I feel like the problem is that I don't write linearly, and so I couldn't have somebody make comments on the first chapter that would be useful to me to revise a chapter and then write the next chapter, because
mm-hmm.
it all gets written, and then I go back and rewrite all of it. And I know that people manage that in writers groups. I can't quite conceive of how.
Mm-hmm.
So far, I've just done it on my own, and then to a few trusted friends, and then to my agent,
mm-hmm.
and my parents read it, and that's obviously not especially diverse. My husband and I seem to share a brain these days, and so having him comment on it is very helpful, but arguably is not giving me like an outside opinion.
Mm-hmm.
It comes in later. I think the other thing that people really love about writers groups is that they're motivating.
Mm-hmm.
You know you're going to meet every second Monday, and so you have pages produced, and that's not a problem I have. I'm very lucky to not have that particular problem, so I haven't solved it in that particular way.
If you had to give some advice to beginning novelists, what advice would you give them?
My best piece of practical writing advice, I feel like, is I always write about everything I read after I'm finished reading it. The piece of advice that I feel like is given most often, and it's great advice, is read. Read everything, read often, read always, as widely as you can. And I think that's great advice. I have found that I need to write about it afterwards. And that's good, because the other piece of advice people give all the time is write a lot, practice. I keep it online. I keep it on a blog. very password protected blog, because it's just for me. But everything I read, I then write about what I learned from it, what they did that I liked, and how they pulled it off, and how I might use that, and what I thought didn't work as well, and why it didn't, mm-hmm. and what I can learn from that too. Mm-hmm. And I actually use numbers or bullet points. I mean, I really enumerate this for myself, and then I have that, and that's another thing I go back to all the time. But it's this practice of learning how to read like a writer, mm-hmm. that I think is really, really useful and pointed and practical, and then I think would work for everyone to step out of the reading experience and think about how to use it for yourself. Almost all writers are really big readers, mm-hmm. and have spent a lot of time reading a lot, but they're reading as readers. And so making that transition to reading as a writer, you give up some things, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. I feel like I don't get to read anymore, and I just think, oh, I just love that, and I have no complaints, and it was problem-free, and it's just great. And I used to read that way all the time. But what you gain, I think, is really, really valuable skills and approaches so that you're learning from what you're reading to for your own writing, things that you can apply in whatever genre, whatever you're writing, however you're writing.
And is that the message you give your students?
Yes, in fact, whereas you're asking me for advice, I just put it right in the syllabus. 20% of your grade will be dependent on your doing this and doing it well. Because when you're teaching, you have that luxury,
right.
to say, I not only believe in my heart that you should do this, I believe it in fact, right. yes, right. you will
you
be
must
doing
do
this,
it.
Yes. There are a lot of things that one makes one students do that one no longer does oneself, and this I do always. I've been doing it for a few years. I've been doing it for a lot of years now, actually, and I do it always, always when I finish a book. And sometimes when I put one down,
that's
also really
more
useful.
Valuable.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Yeah. You talked about playwriting a couple of times already.
Yeah.
Is that what you had originally felt the direction that your life was going to take?
No, it took me a while to get there. But my parents started bringing me to the theater when I was very little, and I loved it, and I still love it. It is my favorite. It is my favorite thing to do, mm-hmm. is go to the theater, which I also do very widely. I go to a wide variety of theater, and I love it. I'm not a good actor, and I can't sing, so it took me a little while to understand what my place was there. And that's how I got to Shakespeare, for starters. And so then that was when I started thinking about writing. It was kind of a natural idea, mm-hmm. that I would go that direction. But then I wrote a novel instead. I can't fully explain how those things happen. The first time, the second time, I made a conscious choice.
Right.
And in fact, sometimes I think about going back and writing the play version of this book because it's so different, just for fun. But the first time, I don't know why it became a novel, mm-hmm. but it did.
Well, we're so glad it did.
Thank you. Me too. I'm so glad it did.
Laurie Frankel, thank you so much. This
thank
has been
so
great.
Much. I appreciate it so much. I've been thrilled to be here. Thank you.